break the silence. We're running away from the dark. Kiss me. Praying our lungs will find us soon. Listen to the heartbeat. Rushing when you hold me. Whispering that this was once our home. Our home. Just listen to the heartbeat.
Been an absolute joy and an honor to share these past 2 weeks and now a third week on this topic of Inside Out. I hope that you all have found it helpful. It has been helpful in my personal life as I've thought through this content and prayed and come before the Lord asking Him for greater wisdom and greater insight. If you're here for the first time, welcome. I know for sure that there are some people here, so I have some family visiting. To give you a quick recap of what we've been talking about, the first Sunday we talked about, the first part of the series was, we looked at what the heart is. And we said this, we said that the heart is an inner process of relating to yourself, to God, and the information you take in. Very simple. Even as I'm here looking at you all, I'm making eye contact with some of you. I'm seeing what you're doing. You know, maybe some of you make an ugly face, some of you a positive face, smile, which is always good. It gives me good feedback. But I take in information. When I read the words of God, when I read His authoritative word, I take it in. And what do? I process it in this internal place where I relate to it. I relate to myself, and it could potentially have the impact of transforming me. So this is the deep-seated part of who we are, the inner control center, the heart. Last week, we talked about how does a heart of stone go to a heart of flesh? And we said that it is a supernatural act of God. And we looked at the example of the Apostle Paul. We said that he was a Jewish zealot. And I want to make a correction that I said last week, because I believe accurate communication is very important. I called the Apostle Paul a Judaizer. He wasn't, in fact, a Judaizer. He was a zealous Jew. You would think somebody who practiced Judaism is a Judaizer, but that's not the case. A Judaizer is a newly converted Christian in the New Testament who would try to impose the Mosaic law and customs upon the Christians. So I want to just make that clarification. I think that's important. But we looked at the Apostle Paul and we said, how does a heart of stone go to a heart of flesh? It happens when the grace of God reveals Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. So you don't have to get on your knees four times a day. You don't have to go and jump in the ocean and cleanse yourself. You don't have to do any crazy rituals. What happens when you are saved is in faith, you hold on to the promises of God, and He provides the revelation, the illumination, not of information, but of a person of Jesus Christ. So that the way we relate to God is through Jesus Christ, which means it's personal. And in this revelation, the Holy Spirit breathes His life into our heart of stone and gives us a new heart of flesh. I don't know how many of you all saw in the news this week, but there was a news report on Fox 5 about a minister here in our area. His name is Dr. Charles Stanley. And on the news, and there was a big event last Sunday, and we honor the amazing things that other ministers and other ministries do because we're not narcissistic enough to think that we're the only ones who serve God, right? We love and appreciate our brothers and sisters around the city. And Dr. Charles Stanley last Sunday celebrated 50 years of ministry at First Baptist Church of Atlanta. Amazing. Amazing that a pastor would stay so long with one ministry. I think he started in 1969, and here he is 50 years later. And a lot of you have heard of In Touch Ministry, and probably many of you have been blessed by that ministry. And to think of what came out of First Baptist Church of Atlanta, you have two people, Louis Giglio and Andy Stanley. Andy Stanley is Charles Stanley's son. Again, two ministries that were birthed out of the faithfulness of God. And to see how God preserved and protected Charles Stanley's heart. Now, he's a fallen man just like any one of us. But he was able to, God through his power, the power of the Spirit, was able to preserve him and help him be faithful in ministry. And look at the fruit that we see. It's an interesting thing because in 1977, my parents immigrated here from Romania, from communist Romania. I'm a second generation Romanian. My wife is a first generation Romanian. And when my parents came here, one of the things was my grandfather was a minister in Romania, and the church was heavily persecuted in Romania. And they were constantly trying to figure out, you know, where's the body of believers? How can we put them in their place? How can we squash, you know, the faith movements? And my grandfather was somebody who was interrogated by the law enforcement and security and communist regime many, many times. So in 1977, my family immigrated to America, and we landed in Chicago. And we had a church there, a Romanian church, and my dad was kind of an antsy guy, also kind of a trailblazer. And although my dad wasn't a minister, he was the son-in-law of my grandfather who was the minister. He said, let's go explore America. Let's go find a better climate. Chicago's kind of a cold climate. It's not that, you know, snow. It's like snows in November. You get snow till like May. You know, very cold climate. And he said, let's go exploring. And so my dad with my mom packed up the car, and they said, let's go explore southeast. So they came to Atlanta. So my dad and my mom by themselves came down to Atlanta to explore the area. They love ministry, and my dad was very curious to find out churches around the area. So he went to First Baptist Snellville back then, where James Merritt was pastor, another pastor maybe some of you have heard of. Another pastor he went to see was Charles Stanley at First Baptist Church of Atlanta. Now, my dad, because he was antsy, knew what persecution did to them and was eager and filled with zeal for the Lord and wanted to create sort of a community and find a place of safety where the church could meet and the immigrants who came here could meet, he decided to go to Charles Stanley's church on a Sunday. And during the time there, during one of the services, Charles Stanley made an invitation for people to come to the front. He said, if you have prayer, come on down and we'd love to pray for you. So my dad, an immigrant, knew a little bit of English, you know, enough to communicate and obviously had a heavy accent. He went down, took my mom by the hand, and they went down and he hung out a little bit longer than the other people because he was eager to meet Dr. Stanley. And so Dr. Stanley eventually saw him lingering and hanging out and said, how can I help you, young man? What can I do for you? And he said in his broken English, he said, I represent a group of immigrants, Romanians. A bunch of us are in Chicago right now, but we're looking to relocate. We came down here. We love the climate. Here's the thing. We need a place to meet. We really love it down here. We need a place to meet. Would you be willing to open your church to allow us to have a space to meet? And Dr. Charles Stanley listened, asked more questions, obviously, and at the end he was very impressed by the heart that my dad had for the Lord and for ministry, and he said, you know what, turn to his secretary. Her name is Mary Gellerstad. She's still there on staff. Turned to her and said, Mary, give this man the key to our chapel, and we're going to let them use and meet here with their community of believers. And that church actually is going to be celebrating 35 years in November. Amazing connection. I say this because of the faithfulness of God, how we see it. And what I'm fascinated by is if we become students of people who have excelled and have been faithful, what is their heart like? How do they do it? And we have the Apostle Paul. Today we're going to talk about the Apostle Paul. And the Apostle Paul wrote an amazing book to a Philippian church. Now, the Philippian church was a church that he planted. If you remember last week, we talked in Acts, we see sort of the story and the transformation of the Apostle Paul. After the Apostle Paul was transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit, he took some missionary journeys where he traveled around the areas there, and what he did was he planted churches, and one of those churches that he planted, or one of the body of believers he planted, was at the church in Philippi. And we read in Acts 16 how the Apostle Paul there was preaching the gospel, ministering the gospel, and there was this little gnat that was following him. It was a fortune teller. somebody with an evil spirit that was mocking him and annoying him. And it says, if you read the text there, it says at one point he was so annoyed, he turned around, rebuked him, and said, in the name of Jesus, spirit, may you leave out of this woman. And the spirit left her. Well, the law enforcement area there got wind of this, and they're like, who is this man? What type of powers is he using? And what they did is they took Paul, they took Silas, they put him in prison. And we have a story there, a magnificent story in Acts 16 about how Paul and Silas were chained in this prison and how they started praising the Lord in prayers and in thanksgiving, and the earth started shaking and they made it out, got out free. Well, now here is the Apostle Paul sometime later writing this book of Philippians to a persecuted church. Now, this is fascinating because I would imagine that if we can take some principles out of a church who has gone through persecution, and there are some principles about how we can navigate the internal realities of the heart, or maybe how we can guard and preserve our heart, then I would imagine that persecuted church, the principles that Paul communicated there should be easily maybe applicable to us, right? Because, I mean, look at our world. We don't go through any major persecution, do we? I mean, I'll take that back. Sometimes you get a comment on Facebook. We don't like it. We're like, how could you say that about me? I'm a Christian. You don't like me. Maybe you got persecuted because somebody saw you with a Chick-fil-A cup. They're like, look at that guy. He goes to Chick-fil-A. You know, he must be a Christian. So I would say we're not as persecuted as maybe my parents and grandparents were in Romania or the church at Philippi, but let me throw this out at you. Things may change. Things may change. So the prayer is that God would work in our heart and that he would do something in this inner process of relating to him, to ourselves, and to the people and things around us. So here's what the Apostle Paul does in Philippians. Just a quick run through because we're going to look at Philippians 4. If you have your Bibles, open up to Philippians 4. But as a quick run through, so the Apostle Paul plants the church at Philippi. When he writes this letter, he's writing from a Roman prison. So keep this in mind. He's a persecuted man is writing to a persecuted church. Probably the church at Philippi is enduring the same persecution that the Apostle Paul endured when he was there and Paul and Silas were put in prison. Keep in mind also, we learned last week, that the Apostle Paul was from Tarsus, which was a Roman city. But he was trained in Jerusalem, so he knew, under Gamaliel is the gentleman's name who he trained under, a very smart guy. So he was trained in Jerusalem, Roman citizen, almost a perfect guy if you imagine somebody to bring the gospel to the Gentiles, right? He seems like the perfect candidate. And so part of the transformation is that God used his gifts and capacities, transformed him, and then used everything that he learned. Didn't cut him off and tell him to get rid of that knowledge because that was stupid knowledge and irrelevant knowledge. He took that knowledge, transformed it, and then used it for his glory. That's something that God does in us. So in Philippians 1, as kind of a recap of the book, some famous phrases from Philippians 1, he says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." He had a deep-seated revelation, again, of who God was, and he saw Christ as the purpose for his life. And he saw that the passing away, that even if he was to be persecuted, he knew that it was gain for him. Why? Because he would be in the presence of the Lord. But you know what? That didn't stop him, though, from giving practical advice and teaching people how to live in the world in which we live. So he didn't have this escapist mentality of let's wait for the rapture, let's hide in our bunker, let's see what happens, let's pray that God keeps the evil people as far away from us as possible. You guys should run, isolate yourself, run to the east and, you know, avoid the west where conflict is. What he does in Philippians 2 is he says, have this same thought that was in Jesus Christ, that he didn't consider equality with God, but he came down and took the form of a servant. And he said this, he said, you all have that same humility, and in humility consider others above yourselves. Wow, what a practical advice to give a persecuted church from a man who's in prison. In chapter 3, again, he elevates our sights from the circumstances, and he says, we are citizens of heaven. Know that the stuff that you are going through, know that ultimately we are citizens of heaven. But he said, everything that I've acquired in my life, and I'm paraphrasing, I count it as trash. I count it as dung is a word he uses for knowing Christ and for moving forward with Christ in this life. So he gets to his closing in Philippians 4. Philippians 4 is a very popular text. And one of the reasons he writes the book of Philippians, very important to know, is why would he write the book of Philippians? Is because he was chained in a prison. Most likely he was chained to a guard. A lot of scholars believe that during that time you're chained to a guard to make sure you don't try to run and get away. And back in those days, they didn't have food service within the prisons. So oftentimes you would have to rely upon your friends, other believers, and you would receive gifts. And so the Apostle Paul in Philippians 4 towards the end says that, thank you for Epaphroditus, I think is her name, for sending this gift, or his name. Thanks for sending these gifts. And I want to tell you that it means so much to me and you've given me more than I need. And so he had this heart of thankfulness writing to the church of Philippi. So now with this context, a persecuted Christian in prison writing to a persecuted church, here's what he says. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentle spirit be known to all men because the Lord is near. And because the Lord is near, don't be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts. Everyone say, guard your hearts. And your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence and if anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. What an amazing thing to write as a persecuted Christian to a persecuted church. Now, I want to focus on that phrase because where it says, "Guard will guard your hearts and your mind." The New Testament was written in Greek. The Greeks had a better understanding of sort of this separation between mind and emotions. So remember we said that oftentimes heart and mind are used interchangeably? There is an overlap heart and mind because we said within the heart there is thinking within the mind. But there's a better distinction now in the New Testament we find with mind as being mental perception. So oftentimes, and be transformed by the renewing of your mind, be transformed by the renewing of your mental perception, the information you take in, the way you view things. Let the truth settle in your heart. Let them change who you are. Because the heart, ultimately, if you remember, we read in Romans, and it said, with the heart one believes, and by belief you are saved. So the inner control center is still the heart, but the mind is important. So we see a little bit of a separation, although there could be overlap. Maybe you have, I would suggest it like this. On one side, we have emotions, pure gut instinct and, you know, emotional rage or a complete, you know, this feeling of bliss and euphoria. And on the other extreme, we have just information you're taking in, mathematics, maybe formulas you're memorizing. And within, you have this blend of allowing the information you take in to change and transform the inner process of who you are. And that's the heart, the control center. Does that make sense? Okay. So Paul is writing this. Now here's the thing. I want us to go backwards. If you're OCD and you want things like perfect order, you know, I'm sorry, but it'll make sense at the end. But I want us to look at this text by going backwards. And here's how we're going to go backwards. We're going to look and see kind of the objective, what does a healthy heart look like? What does a healthy heart look like? And he says there, finally, brothers, dwell on whatever is true, honorable, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, and praiseworthy. So we don't have time to kind of go into each one of these, but think about this. If there was an internal reality of the heart that God wanted us to have, it would be for us to be dwelling, for us to be consumed with what is true, honorable, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, and praiseworthy. Now, this doesn't mean you may be thinking lovely. Well, lovely, let me say this tongue-in-cheek. Lovely doesn't mean looking at somebody with the opposite sex that you find attractive and being like, that's lovely. No. Lovely is your spouse who you should be loving. So we want God to define all of these things, and he does in his word. He teaches us and educates us as to what is true, honorable, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, and praiseworthy. And I would suggest this to you. All of the Christian experience and all of the Christian reality is summed up in a person who is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is like the language of God. If God had a language, maybe not Hebrew, maybe not Aramaic, not Greek, it'd be Jesus Christ, because he's the Word, he's the Logos of God. So anything more in-depth that you want to know about the Christian faith, look at Jesus Christ. Unpack how he lived, unpack who he was, unpack his nature. See how he interacted with the people around him. See how he loved. That's how you can grow in the knowledge. And so if the objective is a healthy heart, so now we're moving backwards, the Apostle Paul says this, that the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding and comprehension, will guard your heart and your mind. There's some good news here for you. I saw it as good news when I studied this. Is that if we're talking about guarding the heart, the beautiful thing is you don't have to guard your heart. I would even venture to say this. So the King Solomon writes in Proverbs 4, guard your heart above all things, because from it flow the springs of life. Now let's integrate the Old Testament with the New Testament. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart. Good news. Because I thought I'm going to have to do some things. Give me a list. Give me some principles. Give me some activities to do. Give me something that where I can guard my heart. Well, guess what? The peace of God does it. And you know how I know it's the peace of God? Because it surpasses all understanding and comprehension. So you couldn't even if you wanted to. Because you can't comprehend how to do it. It is a transcendent power and work of God that he does through the Holy Spirit to guard this inner process in which we relate to him when he transforms our hearts. And the peace of God. Very interesting when you watch like Miss Universe or Mr. Universe, one of the common questions is, if you could do anything, you know, what would it be? Or if you could do anything in this world? And oftentimes you've probably heard it. What is a common answer? World? Peace. People love to bring peace on earth, right? We have the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ. There you go. And you know what? I was recently talking to a friend this past week, and my friend discovered a new form of spirituality or science. And what he said was this, and this is what he threw at me. He's like, Chris, I found this amazing type of medicine and this amazing type of science. I'm like, oh, tell me about it. He said, did you know that every disease, every sickness we have, every ailment, everything we have can be rooted to a conflict in your life? I'm like, oh, okay, sounds like sin. But he said, you know what? You have the power to resolve any conflict. And you know what? I'm going to use an extreme example, okay? But this is a real thing. If you're losing some hair, it's due to a conflict in your life. I said, oh, really? I would love to grow a little bit of hair. I'm losing a little patch here, you know? Can I get some hair back? What do you have to do? Well, I won't even mention what you have to do. It's complicated. You have to pet a cat and do some I don't know what. But here's my point. Every worldview tries to resolve conflicts in our life. Give us some sort of peace, some resolution. This is what Jesus Christ called shalom. When he would meet somebody, he'd say, shalom, may the peace of God be with you. May you have wholeness. May you experience wholeness, emotional wholeness, physical wholeness. And I said to my friend, I said, let me deconstruct, because he's a Christian. Now he doesn't identify as a Christian because he says that we are like gods. We have the capacity to be like gods. You have no idea what potential we have. I said, I would love to meet your guru, I would love to meet your teacher, the person who's training you in this, and just ask him how he's able to reduce degeneration of age over time. I would love to meet him, hopefully before he dies. Because I don't care how strong you think we are, how godlike you think we are, man and humanity has no answer to death outside of the resurrected Christ. So peace, We want peace. All of us want peace. And peace is found in the Prince of Peace. And the Prince of Peace does the activity of guarding our heart. Isn't that good news? That's beautiful, isn't it? And so now we're going to go back. And the main idea, the thought for us is this, is that the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, preserves and protects us. If you want to take notes, that's the thought for you. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, preserves and protects us. And then we have the issue of, as we go back into the text, it says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, through prayer and petition, make your requests known to God. Now, probably, if I was to take a poll, one of the greatest internal conflicts or processes that affects and debilitates us is anxiety. And if you do the research, 1 in 5 people are on anxiety medication or have been diagnosed with anxiety. Now, I don't want to downplay, you know, anxiety, because anxiety can really be rooted in reality. It can. And if you dwell on certain realities which are true, if I dwell upon how fallen I am, and I dwell upon that I'm going to fail again tomorrow, and I'm consumed with that and not with what the objective was, right? If that's what's dominating my inner man, then I'm going to be consumed by anxiety. And I'm going to say something that cuts a little bit. I wasn't really planning on saying this, but if we really get down to it, one of the greatest things that causes anxiety in our lives is fear of loss, right? Fear of loss that you will lose or having lost something. Now, you could be at home, and I'll let you guys know my mind a little bit, okay? Because I'm kind of an existential guy. I'm always thinking the whys, the questions of, you know, deeper philosophical questions. My wife often asks me, Chris, your head is in the clouds. Where are you? But when we look at our lives and we think that even in a home with laughing children and a wonderful spouse that we love, that one day one of us is going to be left by a graveside. It's a hard thought, and it's a reality. But if you dwell just on that reality, you're going to be anxious and probably depressed. But if you see things through the prism of the Scripture, you say, you know what? God has given me a gift, the gift of life. We are failing or frail and going to die because of the sin in the world. And even if I'm that last person standing at that graveside, I'm going to give glory to God. Why? Because I know that my house, my family members are covenant believers in Jesus Christ, and he died and resurrected. And even if I'm the last one, I'm going to give him praise for a wonderful life, even if there were struggles. Because why? Even if our circumstances didn't go so well in life, God transformed and gave us his reality through Jesus Christ and gave us something in here when took our hearts from stone and made them a heart of flesh. And I want to say this. Maybe we think we labor for peace, but the Prince of Peace wants us to labor from a position of peace, so that when we understand who Christ is in us, we can know and operate from the peace, from the shalom that he has given us. So now here's the how. We have anxieties. How do we deal with them? And the Apostle Paul gives us, and again, we're going backwards. He says, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. Thanksgiving does something very interesting. It eliminates a victim mentality. That's another big temptation, is for us to see ourselves as victims. Oh, this happened to me. Woe is me. How am I ever going to bounce back from this? You know, how am I ever going to make it? Why does this always happen to me? Again? Man, look at the church. The church, we're in a post-Christian world. What's happening? Don't you guys see that Christians are being marginalized? What are we going to do? How are we ever going to handle this and deal with this? Man, aren't we in a bad situation? Aren't we living at a bad time? When technology has the ability to overthrow our arguments and debunk our theories, and, you know, they're able to find out this and that, and man, one way to look at it. By giving thanks, we eliminate a victim mentality and we acknowledge what God has done in our lives. It's the first thing of looking up and looking around through the prism of what Jesus Christ has done. So, give thanks. This is what the Apostle Paul says. And he says, how do you do it? By prayer. By talking to God. By having confidence, that have faith that he is who he says he is, and that when you talk to him, he listens to you when you pray. And I think of this. I think back, you know, when I pray or when I talk to God, I think back to an event when I was 5 years old. It's one of my first vivid memories that I really remember. We would go to New Smyrna Beach every single year to a place called the Islander. We'd go with my cousins and my family. And I remember going 1 year, and I was young, maybe a little bit older than Melody, but I went from the 3-foot water. I know I'm tall, but even at that age, I can't fit in 5-6 feet, you know? And so I was going into deeper water, and I started finding myself gasping for air that I was drowning. And you know what I did? I called for my dad. I did. And this may sound a little bit weird, but as I was in that place of losing it, I knew that my dad was going to respond. I knew that my dad was going to show up. I can't explain it. I just knew. If I call him, I call him. I'm in a bad situation. I'm moving towards 5 feet, and I'm bouncing up and down. And you know my dad did? He jumped in, got me, took me out. It's a confidence that I knew. I call to my father, and he hears me. I call to my father, and he responds. And I have the faith to know that he's going to respond at his time when it's appropriate. And for me, I knew that he was going to be there. So maybe when we think about talking to God, offering thanks to God to eliminate the victim mentality, and then for us to offer, you know, beyond thanks, to talk to him, to communicate with him. When was the last time you communicated to God? When was the last time you took some of your problems and some of your sins, the ones we try to avoid and justify and, you know, keep in our blind spot? Maybe asking him, Father, could you reveal to me some of these things? Deal with them. Here they are. I give them to you. In worship. I do this with my family sometimes at night with my girls. You know, we're co-sleepers. So I have both of my girls kind of there around. And sometimes I just lay my hands across the bed and I say, Father, I give them to you. I thank you for them. But even my thankfulness for them is really a selfish thing because they're not mine, they're yours. And I know that by giving them to you, that alleviates the anxieties of how is Melody and Gloria going to grow up? What kind of world are they going to inherit? I say, God, they're yours. The future is yours. It's all yours. Talk to God in that way and see how he transforms your heart. And the other thing, the first thing that he started with, so again, reverse engineering this text. We get to the first thing Paul says, rejoice in the Lord. He's telling a persecuted church to rejoice in the Lord. Notice he says, rejoice or have joy in the Lord. Don't have joy for your circumstances. This is a big distinction. Because we think that we're, you know, we're supposed to be happy and bouncing around and, you know, prancing around at every single, you know, conflict in life. And that's not the case. He says, rejoice or have joy in the Lord. Because if anybody is in Christ, he is a new creation. Live out your new creation in Christ. Don't be a victim. He could have said, man, look at you guys. I feel so sorry for you. I know that you have sorrows, and I feel with your sorrows, and man, maybe one day things will change. He says, rejoice in the Lord because you have a reality greater than the one you're experiencing. And you know how you experience joy? You experience joy by experiencing a greater reality than your anxieties. And that happens in the Lord. When you experience a reality greater than your anxieties, you're looking up, you're looking out, you're looking in faith, and you're available to receive the things of God. So I don't think that the, you know, joy is just something he threw in there and it was like some ideal that couldn't be reached. I think he said, you guys are a new creation in Christ. Know that your suffering is not in vain. Know that we are partakers of the divine nature. Know that we are called to bear with Christ in his sufferings, and that you too are suffering as I am suffering. An amazing thought that the Apostle Paul would have this wisdom and this insight to a persecuted church while he is in prison to give them this advice. And you know what? Paul wasn't just, you know, People give you advice oftentimes that they never follow, right? There are people out there that are experts in diet advice, and they're not on a diet, but they know keto diet and, you know, every diet you can imagine. There are, you know, we're experts, a lot of us, in a lot of things that we don't ourselves go through or haven't done. Now, the Apostle Paul, if I can just remind you back to Acts 16, what happened? Let's look at these contexts here. The Apostle Paul in Acts 16 planted Philippi, was put in prison. What did he do? It says that in prayer and in worship, the earth shook, his circumstance changed. So when the Apostle Paul tells us to not be anxious in anything, but in everything through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, he's saying, look, guys, I've lived this. I've been there. This is a reality for me. Gaze upon the Lord. Offer thanks to the Lord, and that'll eliminate your victim mentality. Trust in him. And I said this phrase, I think it was maybe the first Sunday, and here's the truth. Here's the truth. If you're taking notes, I would write this down. That when we focus on the external world and the circumstances and we ignore the internal realities of the heart, the world by default becomes our internal reality. This means that if we're focused on the world and not on Jesus Christ, the world becomes an internal reality. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, all that is in the world, these things take this space within us. And so what happens when we come to God in thanksgiving, when we talk to God, make our prayers and petitions known to him, and find joy in the Lord, what happens? We invite his presence into the inner process within us that relates to him, to ourselves, the people and things around us. He says it like this in Ephesians 1, 18 through 19. This is one of my favorite verses, I would say, for 6 years. I at one point went to try to memorize all of Ephesians 1 and 2. I made it through 1, I think through half of 2. But this was my favorite, probably my favorite phrase and prayer from the Apostle Paul. This is what he prays to the church in Ephesus. He says, I ask the Father of glory may give you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him. I pray that the eyes of your heart, this is the prayer that you would receive heart sight, may the eyes of your heart be enlightened so that you will know what is the hope. Notice, know. Joy in the Lord comes from knowing what you have in the Lord, right? Joy in the Lord comes from knowing who you are in the Lord. You will know what the hope of his calling is. What are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? And what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe? Heart sight. As we close this series, the Inside Out series, this is the church's prayer, and this is my prayer for you all. Maybe some of you have that constricted heart. Some of you have the regeneration of the Holy Spirit, have the new life, but you know what? We got to live. We got to live after that. And we're fighting two natures, and the Apostle Paul talks about those two natures. But he says here that there is a spirit of wisdom and revelation that comes, and that the eyes of our heart can be enlightened to the realities that we have in Jesus Christ. And I want to emphasize this again because, you know, can we potentially be too theological? I would say our authority for knowing God is the Scripture. What I would say, that God revealed himself in the Scripture. And one of the reasons we don't see life transformation is that we don't know our identity of who we are because we haven't read the Scripture. Scriptures are secondary in our list of doing things. We may have a calendar list of things to do, and probably on that calendar is not even any personal time. Oftentimes, and I'm talking to myself, not even time spent in knowing and understanding. Oftentimes we think, well, God changed my circumstance, and we don't get the wisdom and the insight of how to do it. And I said last time that practical preaching is very important in the context of us knowing a proper theology of how God works in us. Very important that the two go together. So the eyes of your heart, that they would be enlightened, that you would know, that you would have a knowledge. But again, a term there that's used, the Greeks had this term for knowledge, gnosis, which was a deep-seated knowledge, a transformational knowledge. In other words, you don't have to memorize that text. What you got to know is that God is for you, and that God has the resources and the single resource and the power of the Holy Spirit through the work of Jesus Christ to illuminate your heart. So as we close this series now, we want to invite you all into an act. I said the objective is to receive peace today. And maybe there are some of you who have a turbulent heart. Maybe some of you are very, very anxious about certain things in your life. A lot of uncertainty. Maybe some of you have been feeling like a victim. And when you see that the Apostle Paul is able to write and identify some truths that could transform a persecuted church at Philippi, I don't think we're as persecuted as the Christians were at Philippi. What's interesting is that oftentimes great persecution does something to us, brings us to the end of our rope. Now, I'd like to say I pray that the church never gets to that point. But here's the thing, the power of God works anywhere, anytime, in any context, and in any circumstance. So if you're willing today to come before the Lord with this inner process of relating to Him, to yourself, and to the things around you, we talked about Proverbs 4 that said, guard your heart, for from it flow the springs of life. I want you to think about the springs in your life, which are most important to you. Maybe a calling you have from God. Maybe a desire for God to give you a sense of calling. Maybe you're struggling with an illness, with a sickness. Maybe you got some bad lab results. You're anxious about that. Maybe you have some sins that nobody knows about. You've put them off into your blind spot, into the periphery, and you don't even want to acknowledge them. You wonder why God is not transforming, because we're hiding things from Him. Maybe we have lies in our lives. Maybe we have an issue with lust. All of these things, I want you to think in your heart of something that summarizes the most pressing issue right now that is affecting that internal process in you, is affecting your relationship with Jesus Christ. It's affecting how you relate to yourself and to your spouse, maybe to your friends and in your relationships, and maybe you have idolatry in your life because you're addicted to things. Whatever it may be, I'm just trying to name as many of them as possible. What we want to do is we want to invite you to come up to the front. And what we have here, the worship band's going to lead us in a final song. And what the objective is for you to come down here to the front. We have some hearts. What you're going to do is you're going to write a word that summarizes that thing that you want to commit to the Lord. Maybe this is the start of a conversation. Maybe this is a start of you giving thanks, eliminating the victim mentality, and taking personal responsibility for your sin nature and for the things and situations in which you're in. Maybe some things are out of your control. Whatever they are, a word or two that summarizes them, we want to offer them in worship before the Lord. Here I am, Father, I am broken. I give it to you. Here I am, Father, take my sin, because I know Jesus Christ carried our sins on the cross and that His blood washes me, makes me white as snow. And in this communication to Him, we trust that the Spirit of God is going to do a transformative work in your heart and help you live from the inside out, help you live out of the sacred heart that He has put in you. So on either side, there's pens, little hearts, and there's tacks. You're going to write on the heart, take a tack, and you're going to go over to that cross right over there. If you're on this side, you'll walk over there and just stick it on that cross. Nobody's going to know what it is. If you're ashamed of the person, maybe the person behind you, you're going to see something, maybe invert it, put it in. So that's the first step, is to put whatever that source of oppression or charged heart, whatever's charging your heart right now. The second thing you're going to do is you're going to take a heart, a blank heart, and you're going to take it with you. It represents a clean heart that God is giving you. And we're going to talk more about that heart that you have in your hand when you take it. So we're going to take a moment now for you all to come forward and do that as the band leads us in worship.
You.